Welcome to Frank Buckley Interviews. Tonight, it's an actor who stars in one of this summer's big blockbuster films, Skyscraper. It's actor Chin Han.
Frank Buckley Interviews starts now.
Many moviegoers first got to know Chin Han in the Batman movie, The Dark Knight. That role came after a long hiatus from acting, and Chin was as nervous as he could be when he first reported to the set.
And I had one line where I said, I'm not afraid. I mean, you know, you can't even protect yourselves, right? But that one line was just so difficult to get out. But I knew that if I could get that one line out, I'm fine, right? Because I've been acting for so long, right?
Right.
And the entire time, I'm looking at Gary Oldman. He's standing there like this. And Aaron Eckhart is going like this. And he's wicking himself up for the scene. He's wicking himself up.
More with actor Chin Han when we come back. Chin, welcome. It's good to see you.
Hi, Frank. Nice to be here.
You're in another summer blockbuster, this time Skyscraper. Moviegoers are used to seeing you in big movies. Independence Day, Resurgence, Dark Knight, of course, on Netflix, Marco Polo. So many great roles that you've had. Why are you attracted to these sort of big budget studio kinds of things?
Well, you know what? Growing up in Singapore, those movies were pure escapism for me, you know. And I grew up in a time in the 70s when, you know, the country was growing. I mean, it had just attained independence in the 60s, and, you know, there was a lot of construction, and, you know, it was a time of industrialization. So, you know, movies were such a romantic escape for me. And I loved watching these giant movies like Earthquake and even The Swarm or Meteor or The Towering Inferno. And so, you know, I think I have a natural affinity for those movies.
Yeah, I love those films too. Towering Inferno, Poseidon Adventure.
Poseidon Adventure, yeah.
And then Bruce Willis, Die Hard.
Yeah,
and I felt like this Skyscraper is sort of a combination of maybe a little bit of Die Hard and Towering Inferno.
My family is trapped 240 floors in the air.
So what's the plan?
Well, yeah, it's Die Hard, Towering Inferno, The Fugitive, I think, Cliffhanger.
Yeah.
You know, it's an ode, really, you know, and a Valentine to those movies. You know, Bronson is also in his 40s, so I think a lot of the movies that he loved growing up were the same movies that I loved growing up.
Yeah.
So it wasn't a hard sell for me, you know, in terms of when I read the script. I mean, it was pretty quick. I mean, decision to do it.
You're right in the middle of this amazing acting career, but many people don't realize you derailed your own acting career for 8 years before Dark Knight. And tell us about that. Well, you know, how old were you when you started acting, and then why did you stop it for a while?
Well, I mean, my first acting gig, I remember, was a classical play, Molière, you know, this French playwright, School for Wives. And I think I got paid, I don't even remember, $500 for like 3 months of work. I mean, it was insane. And I had to wear the most insane wig you could possibly think of to do the play. So I've been acting for a while. I mean, I was in my teens at that time, and then that started my theater career, and there was a lot of professional theater that I did for about 6-7 years, and then there was I was invited to join a TV series where, you know, I'll be the star of it, and I did that for about 2 years. But that was, you know, at the end of which time, and you know how they are in television world, right? I mean, the productivity and the kind of rate at which they're shooting is so fast. It's a machine, right? Basically. And so I felt that in terms of the scripts and, you know, the people that I was working with, it just wasn't consistent. It didn't align with, you know, how I had envisioned my own career to be.
Yeah.
And I don't want to use the word burnout, but, you know, I was disillusioned, and I felt that there was nothing left for me as an actor to explore at the ripe old age of 25.
Oh, my goodness.
So I decided to go back to the theater, and when I was producing and directing, and I found, you know, passion again in directing and producing, and just didn't feel like coming back, you know.
And then Christopher Nolan comes calling.
So, and then this guy comes calling with this movie, and I had no idea. I mean, I that they were even doing a sequel to Batman Begins, right? And so, you know, the casting office comes calling. John Papsidera, who, you know, has worked with Chris on all his movies, you know, and then you're trying to figure the script down, and they're like, be in LA, right? Saturday, I remember what time was it? It was 10 a.m. in the morning or something. And that was Thursday. I was in Singapore. And I was like, how am I going to make it to LA by Saturday? It's Thursday here. It's a 17-hour flight to Los Angeles. And got here incredibly jet lagged, couldn't sleep. Slept all of like 3 hours, and then I was driving to, you know, Culver City, where Papsidera's office was, and then I auditioned the thing. And of course, you know, long story short, you know, I got the part, right?
Wow. So. And so that changes your life again, right? You're on this path of semi-retirement as an actor, and you're still in the business, of course, as a director and producing things. But it reignites something in you as an actor, or do you just get on the train and here we go?
Oh, man, you know what? When I got the part, I mean, it was so exciting, right? But that was just the beginning. I mean, I had no idea what was waiting for me in London when I first got there on my first day, right? I mean, I was already, it did start the fires burning. It did stoke the fires. But when I got there, it was a bonfire. Because, I mean, the first day I got to London, into London, they said, we're going to drive you out to Coddington, right, in the city of Bedford, 2 hours outside of London. I get there, it's there's security, like, way out, even before you hit the sound stages, you know, and it's like you're out in the field. It's like the scene from Straw Dogs or something, right? I mean, it's like out remote field, giant hangar where they used to keep these balloons, these air...
The blimps, right?
Yeah. That were used during World War II, and then the security, and then security, and security, and then it's like I felt like a secret agent, you know. And then we get there, they put me in the trailer, waited for a second, and then they were like, Chris is ready to meet you now. They take me to the set. It's Chris, Emma Thomas, it's Christian Bale. They were doing a photo shoot in full Bat regalia, the Batmobile, the Batpod, in the underground bunker, and I felt like I was in Oz, basically, you know.
Really?
I mean, it was so stunning, the view, and I was like, okay, I'm in for a ride now, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. And you were.
Yeah.
And I just wonder, so take me into your thought process then, because you go from, I don't want to act anymore, this is not what I envisioned for my life as an artist, to suddenly in one of the biggest films of its era, Dark Knight. And does it say to you, okay, I actually like this, or this was the vision I had for myself, or what was your thought process? Or did you even have time to think of your career at that point?
I didn't have time to think about my career, but it was so exciting. You know, I mean, I think that it was at once terrifying and, you know, it was so thrilling. You know, to be on a rooftop in Chicago with Morgan Freeman, you know, going toe-to-toe with him, or to be in a building, being blown out of that building, you know, on a reverse bungee with Christian Bale. Can I share a story with you about the first day on set? Because to illuminate what I mean by terrifying. So I haven't acted in years. My first day on set was the scene in the prison. There's a scene with Aaron Eckhart, Gary Oldman, one of my all-time favorites, and Chris Nolan. And I had one line, right? I said, I'm not afraid. I mean, you know, you can't even protect yourselves, right? But that one line was just so difficult to get out. But I knew that if I could get that one line out, I'm fine, right? Because I've been acting for so long, right?
Right.
And the entire time, I'm looking at Gary Oldman. He's standing there like this. And Aaron Eckhart is going like this, and he's working himself up for the scene, he's working himself up. And then Chris Nolan, being the perfect gentleman, unflappable, always, in his suit and in his vest, and it's very, you know, British way, and they're all looking at me like this for that one line. And I tell you, that one line was like one of the hardest lines I've ever had to say, because, you know, for all the reasons that I mentioned to you. And I'm like, oh God, they must think I'm terrible. They must think I suck. That's terrible. Gary Oldman must think I'm the worst actor in the world. And he's just there, like, he's just looking like this. So it was a good day.
Yeah.
It all ended up really well.
Right. Yeah. It's amazing to think about, because even, you know, you think about a veteran actor like yourself, you get nervous.
Yeah, yeah.
We don't think of that.
Yeah, I mean, every project is different, right? Every project has its challenges and its demands. I think Marco Polo had all that martial arts that I had to do. And that was nerve-wracking as well, because those that choreography and that fight, you know, the three major fight sequences in the movie were, in the series, were so challenging. Mm. I think with Skyscraper, learning about architecture and buildings and all that stuff and all the technical terminology that I had to spout in the course of the film,
yeah.
That was difficult, because, you know, there's just so much technical stuff, you know, about how a building like that is constructed and comes to pass, and what the fail-safe systems are in terms of all the, you know, how the building would react like a sentient being in the case of, you know, disaster.
Take me through this process. You get the job for Skyscraper, and what is the first thing you do? I assume you already have the script. What is the process that you go through as an actor?
Well, firstly, I look up the dimensions of Dwayne Johnson in terms of height and weight and size to know what I'm up against and how much time I have to spend in the gym before I start shooting. I'm only being half facetious, because he is a big dude.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, and we do have a few scenes in there where there's a bit of a tussle and, you know, some physical stuff. But, you know, when I get this script, with a character that is so iconoclastic, I think, like Zhao. Then I go to look for other iconoclast maverick great thinkers to study. And obviously the most apparent ones right now are Elon Musk, who is just so obvious a choice to look at, and Steve Jobs. And then maybe further back, you're going to look at Edison, or you're going to look at Tesla. And these crazy figures in history, like even Hedy Lamarr, right, who's the actress who also was a prize-winning inventor of the radio guidance system that they used in World War II.
What?
Yes.
I didn't realize
so
that.
So she was not only an actress. I mean, she was someone who invented things. And you get a sense of what drives these people. And what would drive you to build a 225-story building, right? I mean, who does that for fun, right? or to test the limits of human endeavor. What kind of person does that?
Yeah.
And so there's all that reading. And then you start building the character from the ground up with Rawson Thurber, the director, what he envisions for it.
And for those of us who are not actors, we think, oh, the most difficult part must be memorizing the lines. Yeah. But I would imagine for you that's sort of second nature at this point. And then it's a matter of interpreting how to say those lines. And
yeah,
how do you do that?
That is, I don't know, really. You know, I mean, it's hard. I think part of it is intuitive. Mm. You know, I think so I always say, when people ask me that question, I think memorizing the lines is the first thing you do, really. I mean, there's just nothing, you know, there's nothing, that is not even the meat and potatoes of it. I mean, the hard stuff comes later. And a lot of people memorize it in different ways, right? I mean, you can memorize it by repetition, or you're reading the script many, many times, or you can, or you can just like highlight all your, you know, all your parts and just do it independently. I like to read the script over and over again. So not just my own stuff.
Oh, the entire script.
The entire script. And at times I would even like to memorize the lines of the people I'm working with. I tell you why I do that, right? So if I was playing in the Beatles, right, which is an amazing band, if I was Ringo Starr, right, I need to know what Paul McCartney is doing. I need to know what George Harrison is doing. So if need be, I would be able to play their music.
I see.
You know, or their, you know, whatever they're carrying, the tune that they're carrying. So I don't only look at my stuff. I mean, sometimes, you know, if the fancy catches me, I would even memorize my co-star's lines. just wow. for the hell of it. And then you get into that thing where you start piecing it together, and then, you know, and then you try to find the rhythm or the cadence. And obviously some actors have very distinct cadences, like mm-hmm. Christopher Walken, for example.
Right.
And then you find it. And after you've found all of this stuff, right, you go on set, and your co-star might throw you something that will have you change all of it. So,
right.
So, you know, that's part of the course as well. So you always leave that room to be flexible or to be able to adapt, you know.
Whatever you're doing it well, because you've just been invited to join the Academy.
Oh, yeah.
And I wonder what that means to you.
It means a lot. I mean, I think there are a few things that I watched as religiously growing up than the Academy Awards. You know, one would be, I think, the World Cup soccer and maybe the NBA Finals. You know, I mean, the Oscars, I mean, I grew up watching it. I mean, it was the romance of Hollywood, really. Yeah. You know, I mean, these beautiful people going up and, you know, being acknowledged for the work that they've done, which I always felt was some kind of magic, right? I mean, I always think performances is magical. You give someone a word, you know, a couple of words, and they turn it into a performance and a life. So I mean, it was you know, that's what it meant to me. So when I was invited to the Academy, you know, it is very surreal, and to now be in the company of people like Meryl Streep and Al Pacino, you know, and to be acknowledged as a peer. Now, I mean, even though, I mean, to me, I mean, there's so much work left to be done, and those guys are pretty much, you know. Untouchable. I mean, in
but it
in
means that you're in the same league.
Yeah, you know, you know, go figure. You know, but
but it's amazing to me that you're so self-deprecating about it. I mean, people who have achieved the success you've achieved, and who are now being acknowledged in this way as your peers, the people in your industry are saying, you are one of us. You should be in the Academy. And yet you seem to almost question it.
Well, you know, that's the, I think that's the bane of every performer. I mean, you live by the adage, you know, you're only as good as your last performance.
I see.
You know, I mean, so my only hope is to continue to do good work, you know, and just to have a voice now in the Academy in terms of being able to perhaps highlight movies that I like or speak to me and bring attention to them, whether they are from Asia or Europe, you know, I mean, I think is a privilege.
It also comes at a time when people have been scrutinizing the Academy and Hollywood in general for its lack of diversity.
Mm-hmm.
Do you sense that that's changing? And looking back even further as an actor who's ethnically Chinese, do you feel like you have always been offered the roles that someone of your stature should be offered?
It is interesting, you know. I mean, the thing is that obviously sometimes you get a script and you're like, oh no, you know, I'm not quite sure. You know, does he have a life outside of just being a narrative device? You know,
right.
a plot point, or
right. or a punchline.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, and so you seek to expand. I mean, if I do eventually choose to take these parts, and very often I don't, but if I do, you seek to expand, you know, the role, basically. Not in terms of screen time or more lines, but in terms of, you know, something authentic it's a character that someone can identify with, regardless of what your race is. I mean, that you have to be able to identify it as an actual human being.
Right. You know? Not a one-dimensional caricature.
Or that person who's going to create that conflict that drives the plot forwards, you know. So I think that is my consideration. But having said that, you know, I've been very fortunate because I've worked with Chris Nolan. The first four movies were Steven Soderbergh, Gus Van Sant, Roland Emmerich, and Chris Nolan, right? Those were my first
just
four movies.
Just a murderer's row of directors.
and these are artists. So you get a sense when you meet these directors as to whether, you know, they have a sense or an interest or an understanding. And if not an understanding, at least a curiosity in the rest of the world and people outside of themselves.
Yeah.
We're not in a time where, you know, a token appearance of a character of a certain race, it can be any race, you know, is satisfying for that audience. You know, they will know it is token.
Mm.
They will know it is inauthentic. They will know that it's a character that is shoehorned into a story.
Yeah.
And they won't respond to it.
Right.
So I would say, you know, go where your heart is, really. At the end of the day, write what you know and go with what makes you passionate. Don't let the dollar be the driving force that's putting the cart before the horse. And, you know, I think go with the story that you have to tell.
Well, Chin, we know that you're better than okay, and having a wonderful career.
Thank you.
Thank you for the tutorial on acting, and thank you very much for your time.
Oh, thanks, Frank.
All right. If you'd like to hear the entire interview with Chin Han, check out the Frank Buckley Interviews podcast. It's available wherever you listen to podcasts, including on Google Play and on iTunes and at KTLA.com. If you'd like to give us some feedback on Frank Buckley Interviews, tag me on social media. I'm Frank Buckley TV on Twitter and Instagram, and there's a Frank Buckley Facebook page as well. If you'd like to share the show with your friends around the world, you can share the entire show when we post it on YouTube on Monday. Just search for Frank Buckley Interviews. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time.